نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي اللهم فقهنا في الدين رب زدني علما اللهم إني أسألك عِلْمًا نَافِيًا رِزْقًا طَيِّبًا وَعَمَلًا مُتَقَبَّلًا آمين ثم آمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome all of you in our weekly sessions. Alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah. From today, we will be starting our weekly sessions of the discussion and study of Quran. And today, I will be discussing Surah Fatiha, and from the next week we will inshallah be starting from Surah Al-Fatiha, from Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Fatiha, it is a Makki Surah and it has one first by the order of arrangement and fifth by the order of revelation. But it is the first surah which was revealed complete. Before Surah Fatiha, four times was revelation given to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but all the surahs which were revealed before Surah Fatiha were not complete surahs. Only a few verses of the surahs were revealed. Like the first surah to be revealed was Surah Al-Alaq, then the second was Surah Al-Qalam, also known as Surah Noon. And the third was Surah Muzzammil. The fourth was Surah Mudassir. And the fifth time, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was given the revelation of Surah Fatiha. And this complete seven verses were revealed in this fifth revelation. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has explained the excellence of Surah Fatiha in many narrations. Like there is an incident explained in Tirmidhi that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked one of his companions that, would you want me to teach you a surah which is like no other surah which was revealed in Taurat or Injil or Zabur and not even in the Quran? And he asked the companion what he had recited in his prayers, and the companion told that he had recited Surah Fatiha. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, by him in whose control is my soul, nothing like it has been revealed in the Torah, in Injil, in Daud, and in Zabur, and in Quran. And it is the seven frequently repeated verses in the mighty Quran which I have been given. Similarly, Hazrat Abu Sa'ad radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he reports in Musnad Ahmad that a similar occasion that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that he told me and he asked me that I will teach you a surah which is the greatest surah in the Quran before you leave the masjid. And then he took hold of my hand, and before leaving the masjid, he asked me that I asked him that you said that you would teach me the greatest surah of the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yes, it is the surah with which the Quran starts, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And this is the surah in which, about which Allah has said in the Quran that these are the seven verses which are repeated. So this is the excellence that the Prophet ﷺ said that this is the greatest surah of Quran. And then Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala and who reports that the Prophet ﷺ explains an occasion where Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he looked up at the sky and he said that I heard a creaking sound above. And Hazrat Jibreel told that I heard this creaking sound because a door in the heaven has opened today which was never opened previously, and a group of angels has descended which never previously descended. And he, that is Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, will be given two lights, which no previous prophet was given. And these two lights were what? Surah Al-Fatiha and the last two concluding verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. And Prophet added here that you will never recite a word from these two without being given the blessings they contain. And in another hadith, Prophet also gave the tidings and informed all of us that whoever recites these two, that is Surah Fatiha and the last two verses of Surah Baqarah, and then makes dua, his dua will be accepted. And then Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu reported in Nisa'i that Prophet said that should I not inform you of the most noble and the excellent part of Quran? And then he recited Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So this is all the excellence of Surah Al-Fatiha. And then now coming to the names of Surah Fatiha. Almost 25 names of Surah Fatiha have been mentioned. I'll be talking about the most important names. The first name, which is the most commonly known name, is Al-Fatiha. The root word of Fatiha is Fataha, and it means to start, to open, to imitate, to initiate, and to commence something. So, according to the name, it means that Surah Fatiha, it opens the book of Quran. It starts the message of the book of Allah. And this not only starts, or not only is the opening of Quran, we would also realize that Surah Fatiha starts our Salah. In our Salah, after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing we recite in our Qiyam is Surah Fatiha. And it is also advised by the Prophet to start our supplications and dua with Surah Fatiha for their acceptance. So it is very truly called Al-Fatiha. The second name is Surah As-Salah. It is known as Surah As-Salah because the start of Salah is with Surah Al-Fatiha. And moreover, it is mandatory, it is obligatory to recite Surah Fatiha for all people offering Salah. And if Surah Fatiha is not recited in the Salah will not be complete. Hazrat Ubadah bin Samit radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Bukhari and Muslim that Prophet said, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, La salata. There is no salah, there is no prayer. For whom? La salata liman yaqra'a. Liman lam yaqra'a bi fatiha til kitab. There is no prayer, there is no salah for one who does not recite the Surah Fatiha in his salah. So from this hadith, we need to gather a thing, and we need to remember that may it be our personal salah or may it be our congregational salah, it is obligatory to recite Surah Fatiha. Because you know, when we are offering salah in congregation and the imam recites a surah after Surah Fatiha, we might not have the hips of that surah and we might not be able to recite it. So fine, we might just keep on listening what the imam says. But as far as Surah Fatiha is concerned, all people who are offering the prayer behind the imam, they are supposed to recite Surah Fatiha themselves. Because without Surah Fatiha, the salah will not be complete. The third name is Surah Ad-Du'a. And it is known as Surah Ad-Du'a because of two main reasons. The first reason is that Surah Fatiha teaches us the manner and the ethics of dua. And it teaches us and educates about the style of dua we need to adopt to ensure that the dua will be accepted. The manner of making dua, which we gather from Surah Fatiha, is by looking at the arrangement of verses in Surah Fatiha. And can see that first of all, in the verse number 2, 3, and 4, the second, third, and the fourth verses, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying here? Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. So in the second, third, and fourth verse, we learn to praise and glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after this, in the fifth verse, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. This is a promise. It is a pact of the bondsman and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And third and the final, in the verse number 6 and 7, finally is the dua. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. So if we gather about the mannerism, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us about dua is, and if we realize that right at the start of Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us the manner of one of his greatest gifts, that is dua. And that is the gift of supplication. And he is teaching us the manner of dua. So what we gather about the mannerism and ethics of dua is that before asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a matter of respect and regard, we start our dua with praise and glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first thing. That is why, because the surah teaches us the mannerism of dua, that is why it is known as Surah Ad-Dua. The second reason why it is called Surah Dua is that what I narrated a hadith just now, Prophet has clearly told us that whenever before a supplication Surah Fatiha is recited, then the dua will be heard. It will be answered, it will be accepted, and the dua or the supplication will be granted. The doors of heaven will open for the dua, which is preceded by Surah Fatiha. And the dua will reach the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal when Surah Fatiha is recited prior to the dua. So that is why it is known as Surah Ad-Dua. The fourth name is Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book, that is Quran. Mother, we know, has a pivot role in the house, and she is the most important figure in the family. And she is also the most vital and the dearest member of the family. So likewise is the importance and the merit and the role of Surah Fatiha in the Quran, in our salah, in our dua, and in our lives. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has Hazrat Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates in Tirmidhi that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the chapter commencing with Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is Ummul Quran, is the mother of Quran, the mother of the book, and the seven repeated verses and the great Quran. So this is another name. And now the fifth name is Sab'an min al-Masani. This name has been indicated in Quran itself. In Surah Hijr, verse number 87, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمُسَانِي وَالْقُرْآنِ الْأَزِيمِ. That there is no doubt that we have gifted you with seven verses which are repeatedly recited. And then on the other hand, we've also gifted you with the greatest Quran. So here, Surah Fatiha has been called as Sab'an min al-Masani, that is the seven verses which are repeatedly recited. Now, when the Prophet was asked by the companions that what does Sab'an min al-Masani refer to, then Prophet said, by Allah, it means Surah Al-Hamd and Surah Al-Fatiha. And similarly, we've also seen in the previous hadith as narrated by Hazrat Abu Sa'ad and Musnad Ahmad that Prophet said that the seven repeated verses of Quran are what? Surah Al-Hamd. And why is it known as Sab'an min al-Masani, the seven repeated verses of Quran? Because they are repeated so many times. Every rakat of every salah, the starting of every rakat of every salah, we start, we repeat what? We repeat Surah Fatiha. And if you make a calculation of all the farad namaz and the muaqqada sunnah, which we offer during a day, a minimum of about like 31 times are we just repeating these seven verses in our salah. And then we recite Surah Salah or Surah Fatiha before the dua. And so these are the verses which are repeated many times. And from this, from this verse of the Quran and from these words of these ahadith, that they are the seven verses, we understand another thing, that Surah Fatiha has seven verses. Then according to this, it means that Surah Fatiha has seven verses. Now, if you start counting the verses from Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen till Dualeen, there would be six verses. So it means what? It implies that Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is an essential part of Surah Fatiha, and this is included as a verse of Surah Fatiha. So why am I mentioning this? Is that when we recite Surah Fatiha in our salah, we need to recite Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim before it, because if Surah Fatiha is recited without Bismillah, then Surah Fatiha will not be complete, because as I've just said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is an essential and integral part of Surah Fatiha. And if Bismillah is not recited, then recitation of Surah Fatiha will not be complete. And if Surah Fatiha is not complete, then as we just heard the words of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, La Salata illa bi Fatiha, that the salah will not be complete. So we need to recite Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim before Surah Fatiha. But now, many of you might tend to disagree with me, and you may say that in the mosque, when we offer our prayers, the imam, we've never heard the imam recite Bismillah. And even the imam-e-haram, he doesn't even start with the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So how do we relate this? You know, we learn from a hadith in Bukhari that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's manner was that when he used to recite Surah Fatiha, he used to recite Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in his heart, and then he used to start with the recitation of Surah Fatiha loud from Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So all the imams who are leading the salah, they follow the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and so the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the tasmiyah is recited in heart and it is not recited loudly, and the recitation of Surah Fatiha in a loud voice is started from Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And from this hadith also we realize another thing, the importance of Surah Fatiha, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is saying what? He is mentioning the blessings of Allah to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and mentioning the blessings, Allah is saying that on one side, on one hand is Al-Qur'an Al-Azim, and on the other hand is Sab'a min al-Masani. So this indicates and this highlights how important and how vital Surah Fatiha is, and this highlights the excellence of Surah Fatiha. Then another name is Asasul Quran, the actual and the most important treasurable portion of Quran is the Asasul Quran. And then another name is Surah Ruqayya. Ruqya means to recite some verses, that is in form of incantation, recite some verses to remove or to save from any illness or evil deed or magic or the effects of control of jinn. So this surah is used for ruqya and for incantation, and that is why it is known as Surah Ruqayya. And the eighth name is Surah Ash-Shifa. Shifa is because it is proven to be recited to remove and to cure for illness or for shifa. Hazrat Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates. And before that, I would want to explain, narrate the words of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the opening of the book, that is Al-Fatiha, is a cure to every poison. And then Hazrat Abu Sayyid Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates his occasion in Bukhari. He explains that they were on a journey and they stopped over at a place where there was a tribe of unknown people, and a girl came up to them and she informed them that the chief of the tribe, he had been stung by a scorpion, and she said that the men of the tribe were not there, and she requested the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to recite something upon the chief to treat him. So one of the companions went over to treat the chief, and he recited something upon him, and the chief was cured. And the chief was so happy that he gave 30 sheep and he gave them milk to drink. And when the companion came back, the rest of the companions asked, did you know anything to recite upon him to cure? And he said, no, I only recited Umul Kitab, that is Surah Fatiha. And when they came back, they explained the whole equation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him that was it correct to take the reward? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, distribute your reward amongst yourself. So that it was made permissible. And this also proves that Surah Fatiha can be used for incantation, and it can be used for the purposes of curing and for the remedy of illnesses. Verse number one. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the specially merciful. This is tasmiya. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has instructed all of us to say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim before we start doing anything. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that if we will not recite Bismillah before starting any activity or any piece of work, then the work or the activity or the action, it will get deprived of the barakah. And that is why we recite Bismillah before we start doing anything, according to the instructions of Hadith. Similarly, when somebody starts eating food, Hadith says that when somebody starts eating food without saying Bismillah, then Shaitan becomes a party and starts sharing the food. And so we also, there is also another Hadith which tells us that if a person leaves his food behind in his plate, even then the shaitan becomes a partner in the meal. And Hadith also teaches us that if we forgive, we just forget to recite Bismillah at the start of our meal, and we just happen to remember in between that we did not recite Bismillah, then we should recite Bismillahi awwalahu wa akhirahu. And also to highlight that if we are reciting Bismillah at the beginning of the meal, or we are reciting Bismillahi awwalahu wa akhirahu at the in between the meal, if we tend to forget, we should recite it loudly. The point being that if somebody has forgotten, we will help that person remember. And moreover, if there are children on the table as well, they will keep on listening to the recitation of Bismillah or Bismillahi awwalahu wa akhiruhu repeatedly, and they will also develop the habit and remember. When these children who have developed the habit by just listening to our Bismillah, they will, their recitation of Bismillah before the food will become a source of reward for us also. Verse number two, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, who is the Lord of the worlds. Alhamdulillah. These two are very important words. They make the starting of the Quran, they make the starting of our Salah. These are the words we start our day with. Alhamdulillahillazi ahyana ba'dama amatina wa ilayhin nushur. And these are the words when we meet each other and we greet each other. And when somebody asks her, how are you? What do we say? Alhamdulillah. Then these are the words we also say when we complete our food and our meal. And when we get a good news, we have been taught to recite Alhamdulillah alladhi azhaba anil hazani wa inna rabbana la ghafurun shakur. And we see somebody in hardships or in a calamity and crisis, and even then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us to recite the words Alhamdulillah alladhi afani mimma abtalahu bihi. And then when we sneeze, we say Alhamdulillah. And you know what? The first verse of the sermon of Nikah, which Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to recite, the first verse is also, the first words of the sermon of Nikah are also Alhamdulillah. So it is, these two words are of very important. And the meaning is, Al means all, or the. And hamd means praise. So alhamdu means what? All praise be to whom? Allah. Now remember, saying or uttering alhamdulillah, these two words by the word of mouth, these two words, they should infuse, they should inject, they should promote, or they should inculcate four basic feelings in the person who is uttering these words. The first being zikr, that is remembrance of Allah. The second being shukr, that is gratitude to Allah. Third being sabr, that is patience in the obedience of Allah. And the fourth is negation of arrogance and takabbur, that is humbleness. These four activities or actions are what? They are the four steps to Jannah. The first four rungs of the ladder to Jannah. The first is zikr. Now, Alhamdulillah, how does Alhamdulillah train us for remembrance of Allah or zikr? Alhamdulillah, all praise is for Allah. It teaches us what? It reminds us that we need to praise Him, we need to glorify Him in our routine, in abundance, continuously. Then the second thing, shukr or gratitude. Like you see, when someone praises us, someone says, you have beautiful black silky hair. You have a wonderful house. What a fantastic lawn you have. What do we say? We say, a believer says, Alhamdulillah. So this is what? These words make us have a realization that we need to acknowledge and remember the bounties and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, sabr. Like, you know, when we are not feeling well or we are sick and somebody asks us, how are you feeling now? What do we say? Alhamdulillah. This is what? This is patience. So frequently saying the words of Alhamdulillah should make us more patient and more tolerant. And the fourth thing is humbleness. How does Alhamdulillah, the words of Alhamdulillah, how does this promote the feeling of humbleness? You know, like when somebody, a friend of mine comes and talks to me and says that, you know, your son is really brilliant. What do I say? Or what should I say? Am I supposed to say that? Oh, yes, I know. It's all because of my efforts. You know, I really worked hard with him. I struggled. All the boys, their moms used to be sleeping and I used to be working with him. I used to be teaching him. I took him to all the best tuition centers and I used to work and I used to sit with him throughout the night. No. A believer will not say that. But a believer will say what? It is all because of the blessing and karam of my Allah. A believer, by saying these words, will stop depending or will stop boasting about herself, but will accept the fazl and the karam of Allah Kareem. And so, rather than turning into an arrogant and a pompous soul, the person saying Alhamdulillah will become humble, and the person will tend to stay humane rather than being arrogant and proud. So in a nutshell, the message of Alhamdulillah is that we need to remember that we do say Alhamdulillah very, very often. But saying that so often, we need to think is that, are we grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make plenty of zikr? Are we patient? And are we steadfast while obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then saying Alhamdulillah, are we learning to be humble or are we still arrogant despite saying Alhamdulillah? Now, after Alhamdulillah, all praise be to Allah. And Allah is what? Praise is for whom? Who is what? Rabb al-alameen. Rabb means the sustainer. Rabb means the one who creates and then sustains and takes care of all the sustenance of his creation. So all praise be to whom? Who is the sustainer? And sustainer of whom? Sustainer of Al-Alameen, all the worlds, all the creations in the earth, in the heavens, in the oceans, in the skies. The verse teaches us what? The verse is teaching us to praise and glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is not only our provider and sustainer, or the provider or sustainer of our children, but he is the sustainer, the provider, the caretaker of even a nestling of an eagle in the nest on the top of a cliff. He is the sustainer of an insect or of a worm in mud under a rock. He is the sustainer, he is the creator, he is the provider of a fish in the depths of the ocean, fathoms and fathoms of water deep in the bed of the sea. So all praise be to he who sustains and who looks after all the creations in the universe. Verse number three, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Now this verse is telling us what? That all praise is for the sustainer of the worlds. But what is this Rabbil Alameen like? What are his attributes? We need to realize and relate with him. The first attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Quran is that he is Rahman and he is Rahim, the entirely merciful and the specially merciful. These are the two most important and the most vital attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what? We start all our activities, we start with the repetition and with mentioning of these attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our tasmiyah. Now, the root word for Rahman and the root word of Rahim is what? Rahamin. And this means what? Mercy. The translation of Rahman and Rahim both is reflecting the attribute of mercy. So now the question is, when both the words of Rahman and Rahim relate to the attribute of mercy, then why are two separate words used for this attribute of mercy. There are different reasons. Number one, using two words for mercy, number one, to lay stress, to exaggerate, to highlight and make clear of how merciful he actually is. I'll make you understand with a small example. Like you see, when we are explaining about a color, sometimes we use more than two adjectives. Like you might have frequently said, the color of her dress was brilliant, shocking pink. Although if we had just said shocking pink, it would have been sufficient. But we say brilliant, shocking pink. Similarly, we sometimes say bright, fluorescent yellow. Although if you just said fluorescent yellow, that would have been sufficient to convey the color. But then we add the adjective of the second adjective of bright, fluorescent yellow. So this is how it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute of mercy is very, very important to be realized and remembered, because without Allah's mercy, no one can enter Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to highlight, to clarify, to exaggeratedly make us understand has used two adjectives. The second reason is that in both the words, showing the attribute of mercy, but the style, the time, and the manner of mercy is different in both the words. Now, I would want to relate the difference between Rahman and the difference between Rahim. Both are definitely highlighting the exaggeration of the attribute of mercy, but there is a difference. Rahman is a word on the die cast, or it is rhyming to fa'lan in Arabic grammar, and it means merciful beyond limits, crossing limits. Crossing the limits and boundaries in mercy is the Allah merciful. Like, you know, a river, when a river is flooded, it overflows, it crosses the limits and boundaries. So Allah's mercy is flooding, it is crossing the limits, and it is beyond all known boundaries. Rahim is also grammatically on the die cast or on the rhyme of ta'il. And this is also a term showing exaggeration of the attribute of mercy. And the second difference is the difference in time and period. Rahman, Allah, is the one who is merciful in this world. That is before hereafter and before the day of judgment. The quality or the attribute of Allah's mercy is that he is Rahman. In this world, his mercy is beyond limits, but is general. He is merciful for all in general. And you will see that he is. Don't you see? Allah blesses his bounties. His bounties, his blessings of food, health, wealth, children, to everyone. Not only to his believers, to his followers, to the obedience, to those who are offering salah or who are fasting. No, but he blesses with all these bounties even to the non-believers, to the idolaters, to the disobedients, to those who've never even offered salah. Why is this so? Because this worldly life is a trial. And this life is an examination hall. And you know what? In an examination hall, the invigilator provides the basic requirements of a chair, of a desk, the sheets, the papers, etc. to all the candidates. May it be an intelligent and a bright student who has been really working hard in the studies, or may it be a dumb and a lazy student who has just come without any preparation for the exam, but because it is an examination hall, the invigilator provides the basic requirements to all. So Allah is Rahman. His mercy is beyond limits, but it is general for all and he blesses everyone. But he who is Rahman in this world will not continue to be so in hereafter. Hereafter, his attribute of mercy will persist in exaggeration. There is no doubt, but then he will turn from Rahman to Rahim. Rahim on the day of judgment will be highly merciful. His mercy will also be beyond limits, but his mercy will not be general. It will be specific on the day of judgment. It will be specific for whom? For Ibadur Rahman, the obedient servants of Rahman. What does that mean? That on the day of resurrection, Allah Rahim will be specifically merciful to only those who in their worldly life, they received the blessings of the Rahman and acted according to his obedience. They received the blessings of Rahman and they obeyed the Rahman and not the shaitan. They had received the blessings from Rahman and they had been obedient to Rahman and not obedient to shaitan. So these will be the Ibadur Rahman on whom Allah Rahim will be merciful on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Furqan explains some of the traits of Ibadur Rahman. The first being Allah says, Allazina yamshuna alal arzi hauna. Ibadur Rahman have the first attribute that when they walk on the earth, they walk softly. That is, they are not proud. They are not arrogant. They are humble. And humbleness is thus the first trait of Ibadur Rahman. Then the second difference between Rahman and Rahim is that Rahim Rab is one who feels happy when his bondsmen, they supplicate or they make dua. And Rahim and Rahman is a Rab who gets angry when his bondsmen do not avail of the offer of dua or supplication. And that is why Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said, فَأَكْسَرُ الدُّعَى. So make dua very frequently because it does what? It makes Rahim happy and it saves us from the anger of the Rahman Rab. Now, verse number 4. Maliki yawmiddin. He is what? He is the sovereign of the day of resurrection, of the day of recompense. The verse, if we relate it with the previous verses, in this verse, Allah is very clearly summing up that there is no doubt that Allah is glorious. And that all praise is for him. And he is sustainer. He is the sustainer. He is Rahman and he is Ar-Rahim. But remember, he is just not merciful. Just don't keep on relying on him being Rahman and Rahim. Remember, he will also be Malik Yawmiddin. He will be the master of the day of judgment. This verse gives a very clear-cut message and reminder to the reciter about the day of judgment, about hereafter, and reminding of Yawmuddin, this verse of Surah Fatiha, it helps us develop a fear of hereafter. It makes us develop the desire of making preparation for the day of hereafter, and he is the master of the day of judgment. He is the examiner of our last, of our final, the greatest, and the most vital examination. The master about whom Prophet ﷺ has very clearly instructed and told and informed us that on the day of judgment, standing before Maliki Yawmiddin, there will be no soul who will be able to budge an inch until and unless he has answered five questions. And these five questions are what? These five questions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are what? Number one, how did you spend your youth? How did you spend your youth? How did you dress up? What did you talk? What did you see? What did you watch? What did you hear? How did you behave? How did you talk? When did you sleep? And the second question, okay, fine. You were carefree, you were not bothered. You were not that experienced in youth, but the rest of your life, how did you spend your life? How did you spend your life? Some of you might have been given 80 years, some 90 years, some 65 years. How did you spend when you had the experiences of your life and you gained the knowledge? How did you spend the rest of your life? And then the third question, how did you earn? Your earnings, were they lawful? Were they halal? Were they permissible? Did you refrain from the unlawful earnings? And then the fourth question, how did you spend your earnings? And last but not the least, the knowledge you were blessed with, how much did you act upon it? Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafian rizqan tayyiban wa amalan mutakabbala. Now verse number 5. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. It is you. You means what? Allah. It is you we worship and you we ask for help. In the literal word-to-word translation, this is basically, it means what the translation is, that only you we will worship or obey, and only you we will seek help from. This verse of Surah Fatiha is actually a promise. It is a pact. It is a covenant of the reciter with Rabbul Alameen, with the Rahman, with the Rahim, and with glorified Allah. Now, when, where, how do we make this promise and covenant with Allah? Whenever, wherever we recite Surah Fatiha, we are making this promise with Allah. Like, just realize, when we are in our Salah, facing Qibla, all purified, standing in Qiyam, our hands tied up like obedient servants, our eyes, our heads going down before our magnificent Lord, in a state of total submission and humbleness, do we all make this promise with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the start of every rakat of our salah, so many times a day? So, first of all, we need to understand. And secondly, we need to fulfill this promise with our Lord. So it has two forms of promises we are making with Allah. The first is, Iyaka na'budu. Iya means only. And ka is the word for a masculine. And here it signifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means that you, Allah, we will only do what? Na'budu. Now, the root word of na'budu is ayn ba dal. And abd has two literal meanings. Number one means worship, and the second means to obey. So the first meaning is, only you shall we worship. Only you shall we worship. Worships are basically physical, like salah or offering the prayer, fasting, remembrance of Allah or zikr, recitation of Quran, jihad, fighting the path of Allah, then hijrat or doing immigration, performing hajj, and hajj has both physical and monetary components of worship. And then the worships are monetary. For example, paying zakat, or then supererogatory charity beyond zakat in the path of Allah. And then hajj has a monetary component also. And then spending in the path of Allah for jihad, for fighting, and for the preaching of Islam and Quran and teaching, spreading the teachings of Quran. And then there are the spiritual worships like remembrance of Allah, sabr, shukr, reliance and tawakkul, and piety, taqwa, fear of Allah, contentment. So we are promising that we will only worship Allah implies that all forms of worships will be only of Allah and for Allah. Of Allah means what? That there will be no other partners with Allah. This iyyaka na'budu, that there will be worships only of Allah, this negates and puts to an end all forms of polytheism. And as we say in Surah Al-Ikhlas, Qul Huwallahu Ahad, or as we say, we've been taught in Quran to say, Qul Inna Salati Wa Nusuki Wa Mahyaya Wa Mamati Lillahi Rabbil Alameen. So this is basically iyyaka na'budu, that all worships will be of Allah. And the second thing is, all forms of physical, monetary, spiritual worships will be for Allah. They will have no intention to acquire any worldly gain or any worldly advantages. The purpose of the worship will not be to impress people or to gain good popularity or good reputation or for getting any business or political gains or exhibition or show off for worldly purposes. So this is the first meaning of Iyyaka Na'budu, that all the worships will be of Allah and for Allah. Now, iyyaka na'budu, the second meaning, because ayn ba dal means what? The slave. Abd is the slave. Now, what does the slave do? The slave with the master obeys his master and obeys his master alone and obeys his master completely, totally, in a state of total obedience and surrender. So now when we say iyyaka na'budu, the second promise which we are actually making is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are your slaves and you are our master and our Lord. And we will be just obedient to you only. This is the same as we say la ilaha illallah, that there will be no ilah for us other than Allah. So these two, iyyaka na'budu and la ilaha illallah, are what? They are both, this is a covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it implies and it announces that we shall not obey anybody other than Allah, any power other than Allah. It is a clear-cut declaration and announcement by the person, me, you, whoever we say, we make a clear declaration that Allah, if the desires of our soul, the likes, the wishes of our spouse and family, the customs of my family or my clan, the norms of my society, the rules and regulations of or laws of my country, all these orders, rules, regulations, norms, customs, they are according to, or they abide with your orders and your rules and your laws and limits, then I shall accept them. But if any of these, they clash or they are contradictory to your rules, your laws, your commandments, then iyyaka na'budu, for me, obedience is just for you. I shall say no to my family, my clan, my society, and I shall be obedient to you only. I shall surrender to you only. This is a pledge of obedience. This is a promise of total worship. This is a pact to surrender. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us remember and fulfill our promises with Allah, which we regularly make at the start of every rakat of salah, so many times in the day. and in a state of total submission and obedience. And the second promise is Iyyaka nasta'in. From you only, Allah, we will ask for help. We will ask for guidance, protection, sustenance, healing and cure. We will ask for our desires, our needs, our requirements. So this indirectly also puts to end to all forms of polytheism, like calling and asking from prophets and saints and shaheeds or people of the graves and so on. Now, verse number 6. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Guide us to the straight path. Now, this is a supplication. This is a supplication after glorifying, after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the initial verses, and then making a pact and promise with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the reciter is actually making a dua and asking for guidance. Ihdina. Hadal ya means guidance. Ihdina is asking, guide us. As-sirat al-mustaqim means what? The straight path. What is this? Now, as you can see, between dunya and between Jannah, the shortest, the straightest, the easiest, and the surest path from dunya to directly to Jannah is sirat-e-mustaqim. There might be other routes, but they might be longer, they might be risky, and it might not be sure that they might lead us to Jannah, but the shortest, easiest, surest, and even the most convenient route from dunya to Jannah is what? It is sirat-e-mustaqim. So after glorifying and praising Allah and making a promise, we make a dua and we request for guidance to Jannah. We make a dua that guide us to spend our lives on a path which surely leads to our desired destination of Jannah. The reciter of Surah Fatiha asks the Hadi Rabb himself directly for guidance. And it is the best supplication any believer can make. And that is why Surah Fatiha is also called Surah Dua. But now, before I go ahead with the next verse, I would highlight one thing we need to remember. That although we know that this is Surah Fatiha, and after glorifying Allah and reciting Surah Fatiha, when we're going to ask for Ihdinas Siratal Mustaqim, the dua will be heard and accepted. And we can think that we will be guided, but I ask you, is just making dua for guidance, is it sufficient? Just after saying Ihdinas Siratal Mustaqim, we need to stay content that we will be guided. Is it sufficient? Is it sufficient that we just say Ihdinas Siratal Mustaqim and we stay content and we don't do anything else? What do we do in our normal life? Like, just imagine, giving you an example, if you need to go to one of your friend's house, you don't know the location and you don't know the route to the house, it's a new destination, what do you do? Do you just sit after Salah and you just keep on praying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let me, guide me to her house and help me get to her house. Do you just pray? No, you just call her up and you ask her her address and you ask her to guide you to the route. And then nowadays you tell her to send you the location. So your own city, your own locality, we know the roads, we know the locations, we know the buildings, but still we just are not content by praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then for Jannah, just thinking that we will say, Allahumma ihdina siratul mustaqim, and that is going to be sufficient? Do we just make dua for our worldly requirements in this, then just stay content, like just water in our water tank finishes? Do we just sit and make dua? No, we just get up, we switch on the pump, and then expect that the water will come. We do work. We do our effort. We're trying to marry off our children, our daughter or our son, and we've arranged a huge marriage party. Do we just sit and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to arrange all the meal and to arrange for all the arrangements of the marriage party for the guests? No, we run about, we make effort, we plan, we make arrangements of all sorts for the events. So there you are, asking for the road to Jannah and asking for the guidance to Jannah just by saying, اِخْتِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ and thinking that that is going to be sufficient and we're going to be guided. No. We need to do what? We need to pray, we need to ask اِخْتِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time, we need to struggle, strive to learn about the path. And how do we learn about the path? It's by reading Quran and Hadith. As Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إِنِّي تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ شَيْئًا. There is no doubt that I'm leaving behind for you two things, كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. Two things, the Book of Allah and my Sunnah. If you hold fast to these two things, you will not go astray. You will not lose the path. So it is not just praying for guidance, and it is just not staying Allahumma ihdinas siratal mustaqim and staying content, but striving to learn, to read the teachings of Quran and Hadith. So all those who recite Surah Fatiha and all those who have joined us in the session today, let's make two resolutions today. Two firm resolutions today here. Number one, we will sincerely ask for guidance. Number one. And two, we will, with full hard work and struggle, try to learn Quran and Hadith. Allahumma ihdina siratal mustaqim. Allahumma alhimna rushdan wa'izna min sharuri anfusina. Ya musarrif al-qulubi, sarrif qalbi ala ta'atik. Ya muqallib al-qulub, sabbit qalbi ala ta'atik. Now the last verse. Verse 7. Surat al-lazina an'amta alayhim, ghayri al-maghdubi alayhim, wala dwalin. That guide us to what? The path. The path of those upon whom you have bestowed your favor, and not of those who have evoked your anger, or of those who are astray. Now, in this verse, the reciter makes an even clearer explanation of the desired path. That is, O Allah, I am asking for the path of an'amta alayhim. You have blessed, and not of those who are ad-dhalin and maghdub. That is, we are clarifying for ourselves also. We are highlighting for ourselves also that whose path we want to be on and whose path we do not want to be on, whom we want to and we should follow and whom we should not, or we should not even want to follow. An'amta alayhim means the blessed people who are blessed with Allah's pleasure, who are blessed with Allah's guidance and love, and who will be blessed with Allah's mercy and Jannah. And this refers to whom? The prophets, the messengers, the companions, the martyrs, and the guided pious believers. But here again, I will highlight that it's just making dua to be guided on the path of an'amta alayhim is sufficient. Can we just sit and keep on praying that Allah guide us to the path of the people you blessed, and we can expect that we and our children will be guided? No, not for sure, no. What we need to do is we need to study the lives of all of these an'amta alayhim, their manners, their ethics, their obedience, their dealings, what they ate, they wore, how they spent their days and nights, what they earned, how they dealt, what they gave, what they took. And not only this, but what we need to do is, if we want our children to follow the an'amta alayhim, we need to introduce their lives to our children also. We need to introduce the Muslim heroes to our children also. I request all of you to narrate stories of the prophets and the companions to your children. Stop, for God's sake, stop the old bedtime stories. The stories of Cinderella and Sleeping Beauty. And what do we gain out of that? What do we gain out of all those stories? We just make our daughters go and live in a fool's paradise, in a fairy land. And the daughter to whom the mother has narrated stories of Sleeping Beauty and Rapunzel and Cinderella, she lives trying to be Snow White. She waits for her Prince Charming. And then in her co-education university, she starts the hunt for her Prince Charming. And finally, when one fine morning, she walks up with the Prince Charming and introduces the person to her parents, then the parents cry and refuse and retaliate, and we don't realize that how this all started. Tell them the stories of the wives of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Tell them the stories of daughters like Fatima to Zahra, who will be the leaders of the ladies of Jannah. Tell them the stories of mothers like Umme Sulaim, Umme Amara, Hazrat Safiya, Hazrat Isma, Hazrat Khansa. Tell them the stories of sisters like Fatma, Hazrat Fatma bint Khattab, who was a great sister of Hazrat Umar bin Khattab. Introduce to them these jewels and pearls of Islam, the companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so that they may develop the pride of Muslim history. They start feeling proud to be a Muslim. They feel proud to own such ancestors in Islam, rather than being a complex, introverted, and a scared Muslim. And then Al-Maghdub. According to most, the Maghdub means, and it refers to the Jews, as in many verses of Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their being deserving of Allah's wrath and anger and fury. In Surah Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَاءُ بِغَضَبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَغَضَبٍ عَلَىٰ غَضَبٍ. The Jews, because of their behavior of disobedience with full obstinacy and stubbornness, they have been labeled as maghdub. And ad-dwalin, these are the people who were astray. This refers to the Christians, the followers of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, as they were blessed with guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they chose to go astray, leaving the guidance of their book. Now, before ending, I would again want to highlight another thing that would just saying ghayril maghdubi alayhim wala dhalin and then saying out ameen, is that sufficient? Just praying to save ourselves and our progenies from the path of the Jews and the Christians, is just praying sufficient? No, for sure no. What happens and what is happening? Muslims all over the world, they offer salah, congregational salah, they recite the Surah Fatiha, and there's a loud ameen with which the whole mosque echoes. But after the salah, they get up, and what do? Dress up, eat, talk, behave, trade, marriage, all like Christians and Jews, adopting their customs, their norms, their dress code, following them socially, culturally, economically, all respects. Then just praying and saying loud ameen, this won't be sufficient. We need to say no to following them, to copy them, to idolize them, to glamorize them as a nation. As I said in Surah Kafirun, lakum deenukum waliyuddin. For you is your deen, your code of life, your mode of ethics. And for us is our deen, our mode of life, and our code of ethics. This is what we need to adopt in our life. We need to say no to all their mannerisms. And in the end, the excellence and importance of saying Ameen after the recitation of Surah Fatiha, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala, and who narrates that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, whenever the reciter says Ameen, and then say Ameen, for if a person says Ameen coincides with the Ameen of angels, his previous sins will be forgiven. Now, about this, I mean, I would also want to talk about another situation that there are two sects according to the manner of saying Ameen. There is a sect who says Ameen loud, and there is another sect who does not say it aloud. Both the groups not only just tend to stick to their own manner, but they also insist on trying to convert the other to their own. And not only do they limit to this extent, they develop enmity to all those who differ in their manner of saying Ameen. And then pathetically, very pathetically, the two sects, they develop enmity, become opponent groups, and they start fighting, shedding bloods, cutting each other's throats, and killing Muslims. Just a difference of saying Ameen loud and not saying it loud. What are we doing? Where are we heading on to? When we listen to the words of our beloved Prophet saying in his farewell sermon, the life, the blood, the honor, the property of a Muslim is forbidden for the other Muslims. For God's sakes, rather than spending our time, our money, our energies to convert the salah of the other sect to the manner of our salah, let's just work and join hands to invite people to offer salah. There are so many who are just not aware of the importance of salah. There are so many who don't even know the method and the words of salah. So rather than fighting with those who are already offering salah, but maybe with a slight difference from what is our own method, we need to work together to invite those who have never offered salah, who have never bowed down before the Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all from what is important and help us all leave what is unimportant. And in the end, I will narrate the words of a hadith Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Muslim that the Holy Prophet said that Allah, the glorious and exalted, says that I have divided the prayer. Here, the prayer means Surah Fatiha. I have divided the prayer between myself and my servant equally, and my servant shall be granted what he asked for. Therefore, when the servant says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my servant has praised me. And when the person says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my servant has glorified me. And when he says, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in, then Allah says, this is between me and my servant. And my servant shall have what he will request. So remember that when we are reciting Surah Fatiha, and we say, Iyakana, we reach till Iyakana, Buduwa, Iyakana, Nasta'in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already announced that our dua and supplication will be accepted and will be granted. Allah says, my servant shall have what he has requested. And when the person says, Ihdinas siratal mustaqim, guide us to the straight path and the path of those whom you have favored, then before the person has said that, the acceptance and the granting of this dua has been announced by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we supplicate and we make the dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all remember the literal translation of Surah Fatiha when we recite it in our salah, and help us relate to all the important message of Surah Fatiha whenever we recite it and wherever we recite it. رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِن لَّدُنكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنتَ الْوَهَّابُ Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu alayk. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ameen. Summa. Alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah. Today we have covered Surah Fatiha, and inshallah from next week we will be starting Surah Al-Baqarah. I will request all of you to invite your friends and your cousins and your relatives and as much as you can to follow the live sessions on Facebook or YouTube, or to join with the invite link you're provided to join our WhatsApp groups. Stay connected and stay blessed. Fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.